I think one of my, you can be seated. I just forget about that part. Or we can stand for an hour and a half. It's up to you. One of my favorite things about those songs that is the truth that we get about redemption. There's something about redemption I think is particularly amazing. And that is the fact that without Jesus, not only was I not redeemed, I was lost in sin and darkness. And so to be redeemed into the family of God is huge. And I hope that if you have not experienced that, that is something that you would seriously consider today. We are going to be in John chapter 17 today. John chapter 17, as we turn there, let me go ahead and pray for us. Lord God, thank you for this opportunity to be able to sing songs about the redemption that we have in Jesus. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to sit amongst fellow believers, fellowshipping under your name, to be able to grow a little bit more like Jesus today. God, thank you for the ability to have your word, the Bible, in front of us, to be able to read what you have to say. May it help us, God, to become more holy, to really be a great example of what it means to be redeemed amongst this world. So God, we love you, we thank you. Holy Spirit, give us wisdom and insight into our hearts. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So for those of you that don't know me, my name is Jim Scott. I'm a missionary with the North American Mission Board. Bye, kids.
We always like to interrupt service.
Yes, that's perfect. That's awesome. Yeah, and thank you to everybody who's volunteering and helping teach the kids. That is awesome. My name is Jim Scott. I'm a missionary with the North American Mission Board, working with the Nevada Baptist Convention to help plant churches in Northern Nevada. And so years ago, back in 2004, when I got out of the Marines, I moved to a town called Pahrump and started working in law enforcement there, and which was great. And after a few years, God had actually called me to plant a church. And so I did. Myself and some other families, we had started a church. So it would have been back in 2012. And since then, a few years later, ended up pastoring that church full time. And God ended up calling me out into the mission field to help plant churches in Northern Nevada. Now, that is the quick story to tell you that, you know, it wasn't easy to get from leaving in 2004 all the way to moving up here. I had grown up in Southern Nevada, born and raised in Las Vegas, and so it was very interesting to be able to move from Southern Nevada to Northern Nevada. The weather's a little nicer, which is good. I appreciate anything below 100. So anything above 100 is too close to hell for me, so I appreciate that. And I like the fact that moving out here, there's such a great opportunity for mission in Northern Nevada. In fact, even now, as we speak, we have men stepping out, starting churches in Reno, starting churches in Winnemucca, out in Rendon, Osceno area, right outside of Elko, and then also a town called Jigs, right outside of Elko. And so it doesn't matter if it's a big city, small town, as long as there are people there who need Jesus, that's where we're going to go. And so those men are out there working in the field right now, and we even have men getting ready to be assessed to plant churches in other places as well. And so if you can be in prayer for the mission of God in Northern Nevada, I would appreciate it. I also thank you so much for your partnership and really the prayers that you've already sent our way, because there are so many people in Northern Nevada that need Jesus, and it is the presence of God's people that can bring that opportunity to them. And so kind of moving on, so now that we're here in Reno, my family had moved up there almost about 2 years ago now. This is a very interesting move. You know, my wife, whom I've been married to for about 17 years, almost 18, we've had a great experience raising our kids, our oldest who turned 16 on Monday, and our youngest who will be born in December. And so we have, six kids. So we need a new car. And And it's been great. You know, I have one kid in high school, one kid in junior high, one kid in elementary school, and the rest of them are at home driving mom crazy. So thank you for inviting me today. you'll get it. If we laugh, we'll have more fun. So for me, I was raised in a house, but I was about 8 when my brother and sister were born, and it was great growing up in a house with a few brothers and a sister. My son gets to grow up around 5 sisters. So pray for that boy. He's in junior high and he has 5 sisters. So, but we love it here so far. Just awesome stuff happening. The Lord leading in so many different directions. One of the things I was thankful for was being able to do my first baptisms in Lake Tahoe. That was not warm. There's nothing warm about that lake, but it was beautiful. Best pictures ever. And so we really love Northern Nevada, and we're really glad that we're here. And so, you know, we had really moved into this year going, okay, we're kind of settled in. We finally got settled in. Any of you move after living somewhere for a long time? We've been in the same house for like 12 years. Yeah. So we ended up moving, and then sometime around February, this thing called COVID happened. Did you hear about that? And it just completely changed the trajectory of what we were doing. It was shocking to be able to tell my daughter, whose very first year of high school is completely interrupted. My son, whose very first year of junior high is completely interrupted. And then to be able to have to tell him, sorry, son, you're not going to be able to play football this year. And, you know, just like, sorry, daughter, you're not going to be able to do that other extracurricular activity. You know, all that stuff where life continually is changing. And I don't know if you felt any pressure lately, but I know that we have. We felt some pressure. There was a time when we weren't able to go to church. I remember sitting with my wife, and she just started tearing up. And I asked what was wrong. I knew it was wrong. But you know when you're a husband and you don't want to be wrong, you ask. So I said, what's wrong? And she says, you know, I just miss church. And it's true, isn't it? It's like you miss the fellowship of God's people. And even with social distancing and all the stuff, man, 6 feet still too far apart, you know? And so it's been tough, and the isolation that's there, it just brings things up, brings depression, it brings anxiety, you know? I don't think that we were created to live in that kind of isolation. But one of the things that I noticed recently is the rise of depression, the rise of anxiety, the rise of uncertainty. The Kaiser Family Foundation, they said, they did a survey. They said 49% of Americans have had a pretty good mental health impact because of everything that's happened. They said 19%, this is since April, just in April, 19% has had a major impact. There's this federal emergency hotline that you can call when you're in severe mental health distress. Since February, starting in April compared to last April, a 1,000% increase in calls. 1,000, that's April. Since February, this online place called Talkspace, it's a place where people can go to get counseling online, it has increased 65% since February. 1,000% increase in calls, 65% increase in counseling sessions, 19% saying that it severely has been affecting their mental health. We see that climb. I don't think I need to give you the numbers because I feel like you know this. I feel like you have family members and friends and maybe even yourself. You just feel the weight of this season. And we're not even talking about everything else that's going on. We're simply talking about this. And so right now, I mean, it just brings a whole lot of pressure on us, doesn't it? I mean, I was at Maverick the other day, and I was just getting some gas. I'm like, I'm going to go get a soda. I went and got a soda, and I stood there, and I was thirsty. And so what happens when you're thirsty sometimes? I gave a little cough, and I thought I just shot a gun. Right? It's literally like, I don't know, I'm going to stand over here. I'm like, that's the other side of the store, and I need to buy this. You're the cash register person. And so when you're like just that kind of like, it's the angst and just the stress of everything, man, we see it, don't we? And we feel it. And it's hard. It's very hard. On September 2nd, so just the other day, this article came out called The Prevalence of Depression Symptoms in U.S. Adults Before and During COVID-19 Pandemic. Google that. But this is what it says. I'll sum it up for you. These findings suggest that prevalence of depression symptoms in the U.S. was more than threefold higher during COVID-19 compared with before the COVID-19 pandemic. Individuals with lower social resources, lower economic resources, and greater exposure to stressors such as job loss, etc., reported a greater burden of depression symptoms. And what I'd like to kind of focus a little bit on today is this idea of social resources. At the end of the day, social resources are the friends that will walk with you through hard times. You know what I'm talking about. In fact, you've probably been that person before. But see, over time and even through generations, these kind of social resources and these friendships have become harder and harder to find. It's not because they're not out there. It's not because they're not out there. But here's the change. If you were born between 1946 to 1964, then you are a baby boomer. And you probably had a lot of fun in the 70s. But here's the reality of it. You didn't know what a Facebook was. You didn't even know what an internet was, right? Who had internet? I mean, I don't know if it's you, but if you're a baby boomer, maybe you even still have it. The address book that you handwrite someone's name, number, and address. And if they move, what do? Change the address. I have never done that. I've never done that. It was actually a surprise. My daughter, who's 4 years old, was playing with these things. And my wife's like, no, don't lose those. Those are stamps, right? I was like, we have stamps? And she's like, yeah, just in case. How long have you had those? She's like, I think 2 years, you know? But there's a difference, the generational difference, isn't there? Like, you know, you have the address book. And so like later on, Generation X, 1980 to 1985, that was the generation that sometimes 2008, they're like, yeah, I'm going to jump on Facebook. I understand a little bit about the internet. But there's a difference in this generation, right? It's the beginning of what we considered a highly connected generation, but a very low social resource generation, in the sense that we feel a little bit higher connected because we see things more often on social media, but we're actually less physically present with people. For the millennial generation, which is where I come in, 1980 to 1995, we live on social media. Everything comes from that. My Facebook, my Instagram, my Twitter, all those things, all these sort of things are very important to me, constantly on it. I can give you 100 people that I've liked pictures. I see their kids. I see what their kids are doing. I see the food that they're eating. I see the food they shouldn't be eating. Like I see all this stuff, and I feel super connected, but you know what? Haven't had dinner with them. Haven't had lunch with them. Haven't had a cup of coffee with them. Haven't shaken that guy's hand for 16 years or I don't know, whatever. You know what I'm saying? I mean, there's people I can say, yeah, I'm super connected. Hundreds of people like me or friend me on social media. But the reality is I am less connected to people than, say, some of you are. Because the reality is over the generations, what has happened? We have created our physical presence in people's lives has become more and more and more distant, even though we, quote, feel socially connected. Generation Z, which is the generation born in 1995 to 2010, this is a very interesting thing because, you know, for a while, like Generation Z, they must be babies, and they're like 20 now, you know? And the reality is that this generation is so connected to Instagram and YouTube and everything. It's such a highly connected generation, but it compared to the baby boomers, it is so physically distant from any other generation to people. And when we see the statistics of 1,000% increase in phone calls and 49% with mental health issues, and we see all these statistics jumping up, we got to ask the question, well, why is this happening? And you get to see the consistent distancing that is taking place to where we are no longer physically present in somebody's life, even though we're, quote, connected to them socially. This is a very difficult thing for us to process, especially because we don't have a very broad concept of the world. But the reality is that our presence matters in people's lives. You matter to me. People matter to you. But it's not just that they exist, it's that you physically exist in their life. You actually matter. And let me tell you something, God wants it that way. If you're in your Bibles, John chapter 17, verses 16 to 19, I'm going to read out of the Pew Bible. It's page 1286. John chapter 17, verses 16 to 19, this is what it says. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth, thy word is truth. As thou didst send me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they themselves also may be sanctified in truth. Now, here's what I want you to consider for a minute. I want you to see the correlation between these two phrases. You ready? Verse 16 says, they are not just as I am not. Not being the negative phrase there. See, this is not what I am. This is not who you are. This is what Jesus is saying. And then in verse 18, he says, just as you have sent me, I am sending them. In other words, this is who I am, and this is who you are. Now, let's talk about who we aren't at first, because the first part in verse 16 deals with our relationship to what the Bible would call the cosmos or the world. But when he talks about world, it's not just the physical presence of the world, but all of God's creation in this sense. And so when it comes to all of God's creation, what he says is this, is that they are not of the world just as I am not of the world. Now, clearly we are in the world. Clearly we're created physical beings. We have flesh, bones, these kind of things. And so we're going to work through that. But verse 18 deals with your purpose in the cosmos. You see, whereas verse 16 deals with your relationship with the world, verse 18 deals with your purpose in the world. Your relationship is relative. Your purpose is your presence. This is the reality of the situation, is that your relationship to the world is relative, but your purpose in this world is your presence. Verse 16 says, they are not just as I am not. Your relationship is relative because it is in proportion to something else. What is that? Look at verse 17. Sanctify them in the what? Truth. Now, truth, we're talking the objective truth of God, not the subjective truth of man. Subjective truth of man is when I say I like chocolate ice cream and you go, Jim, you're crazy. It's all about strawberry, right? Neither of us are really wrong. We just have preferences. But if you go and I say, I think murder is right. And you say, no, murder is wrong. That's not a preference thing. I'm wrong. Murder's not okay. Are we clear on that? Okay. So when it comes to objective truth, we know that there is objective truth that comes from God. We call that truth. Why? Because it is universally true. It is a very true thing. There is no way around it. There is no gray area about it. It is simply the objective truth of God. And so when he speaks of this, he says that this is what sanctifies us. Sanctification is simply being set apart as holy, as blameless, as perfect. So when God's truth, which is holy and blameless and perfect, is now applied into our lives, we too can live in that space of holiness. So God brings us into that sanctification immediately in our salvation. Praise be to Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for bringing us there. And then we progressively become like Jesus as time goes on. But in this scenario, what we are talking about here is that the truth of God is what separates us from the world. Because this is the crux of the matter. This is the problem. Romans 1, chapter 1, verses 24 and 25 says this: therefore God gave them up to the lusts of their hearts, to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves. And here's the key, you ready? Because they exchanged the truth about God for what? A lie. Meaning they said, this is who God is, and then they took what it is, and then they changed it to make a subjective God, a lowercase g God, one that just does not exist, to give them permission to do the things they should not do. This is not uncommon. This is what, quote, the world does. But this is what separates us or sanctifies us in verse 17. Sanctify them, separate them from that lie, separate them from those false gods, separate them from that subjective truth, separate them from that culture that's going to hell. Separate that in what? Truth. Sanctify them in truth. Now here's what's so important about this. This is Jesus' prayer for you. You ever pray? I mean, you ever pray with like, where your heart is just like, God, please. That's Jesus's prayer here. Jesus isn't just saying some things. He's praying for you right now. He's praying to his Father in heaven, saying, just as I am not of the world, neither are they. Sanctify them in truth. And then he says, what is true? Thy word, your word. God, your word is truth. What is true? God's word. God's word's always true. God's word is always true. But see, being sanctified in truth is the opposite of exchanging the truth of God for a lie, isn't it? It absolutely is. It is completely opposite. And your being of the world is highly dependent upon your relationship with the truth. If you're not of the world, just as Jesus is not of the world, then that means that you are following the truth of God. The truth of God, God's word is solely truth. Psalm 119 verse 160 says this: the sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever. Every one of them. You ever grow up in a household with rules? Anybody have rules growing up? I know like one of mine was like, you know, be home before the street lights. Couldn't use that rule when we moved to Pahrump, no street lights. Right? But there's some rules, right? And I'd say like, I think when it came to my mom, like I love my mom, love my dad. I'd say they were about 75% right, right? I was growing up, I'm like, I'll follow about 75% of the rules, but the other 25 I kind of want to do on my own. I think maybe you're mistaken. That's what we do as kids, right? But spiritually, friends, we're not kids. We can't look at the rules of God and go, God, you are almost always right. God, you are so right until I want to do something else. What does the psalmist say here? The sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever. There's not one rule of God that doesn't exist in the space of eternity that will not apply to us for eternity. There's not one rule. So what does that mean? Every generation, God's word is the same. Every generation, God's rule is the same. Every generation, God's word is righteous and applies and is good. In other words, for every generation, God's truth is what sanctifies us. And that never changes. God's truth is his word, His word is His rules. And here's what Jesus is praying. Jesus is praying that His people would be defined as those who hear and obey God just as He did. That we would absorb this identity, like I tell my kids all the time, of being a good listener. That we would hear God, but then we wouldn't just hear it, we would do it. There's this one pastor who gave an analogy that just kind of popping up my head, but he's like, I can't imagine if I walked in, told my daughters, like, hey, clean up this room. It is a mess. And then they say, okay, Dad. So I leave, I come back in a few hours, and the room's still a mess. So I say, why is your room still a mess? And then the daughters say, well, we've been praying about it. We've been praying about it. Oh, we're going to seek some counsel later. I mean, I know it's what you say, but we'll see if that's something we want to do. We can easily do that with God's word, can't we? God, I know you say to do it, but I got some other stuff to do. How about I do 75% of what you want? Really, paraphrase what Jesus is saying is this, is that we aren't like the world because we listen to you, God. We aren't like the world because we listen to you. Look, I don't want any crossed arms for this. Don't get mad at me. All right, I'm watching everybody. Doesn't matter if you watch CNN or Fox. Are we still friends? Okay. When it comes to the economy, what does God's word say? When it comes to government, what does God's word say? When it comes to race relations, what does God's word say? What do God's people do? When it comes to disease, what does God's word say? What does God's people do? We hear and we obey God's word. If we're being informed by television what to think more than we're informed by the word of God, can we be called a Christian? When you see this, this kind of blows my mind a little bit. Because then I even thought about suffering a little bit, you know? Suffering, Luke chapter 22, verse 42, Jesus is praying again, and he says, Father, if you're willing to take this cup from me, in other words, the cup of wrath that was about to be poured out on Jesus on the cross. I mean, he's about to be tortured and nailed to a cross and die. Horrible death. What does he say? But not my will, but what? Yours be done. And he's talking about, I know, God, you have for me to go to the cross to die. Jesus didn't say, how about 75%, God? I mean, I'll do everything else, but the cross is too much. What did Jesus say? Not my will, but yours be done. I am not of the world just as they are not of the world. Well, why? Because Jesus listened to his Father and did 100% what he said, even the hardest thing. And the reason why we are able to be like Jesus, or one way we can be like Jesus, is by listening to God. You know what I love about this too? It's not like I get to listen to God and let me just like get to kick a rock down the road. Like, this is the worst. I got to listen to God. Ugh. You know? Guess what he says? Luke 11:28. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and what? Observe it. You're blessed. You are blessed if you hear the word of God and you do it. Somebody's like, hey, I want blessing in my life. What should I do? Follow God. Listen to God. Do what he says. Yeah, but what about in this scenario? Follow God, listen to God, do what he says. I feel like a cheerleader, you know? Like, you just got to do it. You just got to listen, and you just got to do it. Well, I don't know. It might be a little bit hard. Follow God, listen to God, do what he says. And I just want to say that over and over and over and over. Why? Because if somebody wants blessing in their life, God made it simple. He made it simple. Listen to me. Listen to me. If you don't, and you decide to sin, you're going to face the consequence of your sin. But if you listen to me, then you will be blessed for it. Jesus went to the cross. I don't know that I would have. That would have been hard. I mean, I like you guys, but cross, man. Whew. Jesus, he did it. No matter how hard it was. But here's the key right here. Like, he did it. He embraced that. We must embrace our sanctification, our set apartness, what makes us different. We got to embrace this. This is something we should run from, something we should compromise. We should run to it. We should embrace it. We should follow it. We should do it. But we have to embrace it before we can understand what comes next. And that is, everyone in this room who is a Christian is a missionary. You are on mission from God. It's like the Blues Brothers, right? I'm on a mission from God. That's you. You are on a mission from God. You are saved by grace through faith. Your salvation sets you apart. It sanctifies you from the world, but it doesn't remove you from the world. I mean, some of you woke up this morning and you're like, well, there's another one. If you ever wonder why you have so many birthday candles on your cake, that's Jesus' fault. Every time. You wake up and you go, man, another day? That's Jesus' fault. Why are you here? It's Jesus' fault. Look what he says in verse 18. As you sent me into the world, I am sending you into the world. So why are you here? Because Jesus has sent you here. And you know what? He's not just you in this kind of metaphorical sense. Like, your actual physical presence here and now and everywhere else that you will go throughout the week. Your physical presence exists by the very prayer of Jesus Christ, who says he is sending you into the world to exist amongst the world. Now, why is this important? Think about this. The Great Commission, making disciples. It cannot happen without your physical presence. It cannot. How are we going to tell anybody about Jesus in Iran if we don't have anybody going? How are we going to tell anybody about Jesus in Dayton if we don't have anybody there to say something to them? The Great Commission requires your physical presence. Then there is also the Great Commandments. Love God, love others. Can only be done with your physical presence. Evangelism, gospel sharing, telling people about what Jesus did can only be done with your physical presence. It's the only way. Think about that for a minute. Your physical presence matters. And so in Jesus' prayer, in verse 18, when he says, as you send me into the world, I have sent them into the world, what he's saying is he has sent you, and that is your purpose. You see, when it comes to us not being of the world, it's relative to our relationship with the truth of God. But when it comes to us being in the world, that has to do with our physical presence and our being sent. Now, here's the thing. How was Jesus sent? Anybody remember John 3:16? I hope so, because you can't get into heaven without it. It's a mandatory Bible memorization verse. Or a coffee cup. You can bring a coffee cup too. When it comes to John 3:16, a lot of us know, what about John 3:17? For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Now hold on a second, because this is sounding really close together. Just as you have sent me into the world, it's what Jesus is talking to his Father, right? Just as you have sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Well, how was Jesus sent? John 3:17. God didn't send me. Do you hear that? He didn't send me into the world to condemn the world, that the world might be saved through Jesus. This is you. You could be saying this to God. Just as you sent Jesus into the world, God, you're sending me into the world. How were you sent, Jim? Well, I'm not here to condemn the world, but that the world could be saved through Jesus. That's my job. It's to tell people about Jesus so that they would be saved through him. Just as Jesus was sent and did that, so am I am sent to do that. The parallel is striking. And yet, we might ask, what does it look like to be sent into the world? How do you know if you're doing your job as a Christian? How do you know if you're doing the right thing? Right? Because that's a hard one, right? Especially with the diversity of objections to Christianity and things like this. So John 10:10. I try to make it easy. John 17:17. John 10:10. John 10:10 says this: I have come that they may have life and have it to the fullest. Just as you sent me, I am sending them. I didn't come into the world to condemn the world. I came to the world to save them through Jesus. How do I know if I'm doing a good job? I have come that they may have life and have it to the fullest. I love what D.A. Carson writes about this. He says, this is a proverbial way of insisting that there is only one means of receiving eternal life, only one source of knowledge of God, only one fount of spiritual nourishment, only one basis for spiritual security, Jesus alone. You see, here's a big misconception that is in our world. This is the exchanging the truth of God for a lie part. The misconception is this: you can live life to the fullest without a relationship with Jesus Christ. And friends, that's a lie. The fact is that for us to live life to the fullest, we must have Jesus Christ. Well, why? That's what Dr. Carson just said. Without Jesus, there is no knowledge of God. Without Jesus, there is no spiritual nourishment. Without Jesus, there is no spiritual security. How are you to live your life fully without knowing who your Creator is, without growing spiritually, and without being secure in your salvation? How are you going to grow and live life to the fullest? You can't. You can't. And as Christians, we understand this truth. It only comes from a reconciled relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And here's the second misconception: that you're here because of, you know, retirement or a job or a friend or financial situation or your car broke down. I don't know, however you landed in Dayton. Was anyone born and raised in Dayton? No? Okay. There's got to be one. So when it comes to this, I want you to think about this for a second. If the truth of God is this, that to live life to the fullest, I must know God. That's what the truth of God tells me. I must know him, and my soul will be nourished, and I will have this internal security. That is amazing. That's what the truth of God tells us. Here's another thing. You aren't here because of any of those circumstances. You're in Dayton because you are sent by God. You're in Dayton, and it's Jesus' fault. The reality is that you are here because Jesus has sent you here. We all know, Jim, it was a job thing, it was a retirement thing, nope. Guys, don't exchange this truth. The truth is that you are sent. Just as you have sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. You have been sent here by God. And probably one of my favorite quotes, I can't remember who said it though, has to do with the purpose of that. There are two things that you can do on earth that you can't do in heaven. And what is that? Sin and tell people about Jesus. What do you think he has you here for? You see, friends, when it comes to your presence here in Dayton locally, God has put people around you, and you have to begin asking the question, why? And then you need to be hearing these words from John 17, 18. Just as God had sent his Son into the world, he has sent me to you. And that puts a little bit of weight on that relationship now, doesn't it? No longer is it just going to Family Dollar and picking up some decorations. No longer is it just going to the gas station. No longer is it just going to work. No longer is it just saying hi to that neighbor. Now you have to, you must, if you're going to listen to God 100%, not 75%, but you're going to embrace the entire truth of God, then you must look at that relationship as a missionary opportunity to bring somebody who does not know Jesus into a sanctified relationship of truth with Jesus Christ so that they can live life to the fullest and so that they too can be sent to tell the next person. Because this is God's design. And one day I hope that you will have some Jesus-empowered stories to tell people. One pastor actually had this quote, I thought it was good. This isn't the time to wait. Hell is hot and forever is a long time. He's right. Lost people need to be reached. Churches need to be planted, and nations need to be evangelized. Let's have some amazing Jesus-empowered stories to tell our grandkids. You know, I'm very thankful for my grandfather, some of the stories that I heard from him. I'm thankful for a man named Jose Tejas. He's a retired Marine. He got a Silver Star in Vietnam. And you hear some of his stories, and man, just be blown away. I'll never forget those stories. He's the kind of man that I talk about frequently, actually, because I love that guy so much. But you know what I'm sort of a little bit kind of afraid of? I'm 38, so I'm not young, but I feel like I'm getting there. And I'm kind of afraid that I won't ever have any stories to tell my grandkids that are Jesus-empowered moments. Any stories that I can leave with them as a legacy for them to hold on to for the rest of their own life to be able to tell their kids and their grandkids. I could tell them stories of, you know, being in Iraq. I could tell them stories of being a cop. Man, I want them to hear some Jesus-empowered stories from my life. Because I'm a little afraid that one day they're going to be reading the Bible and my grandkids are going to get to the part where it says here that God sent Jesus into the world and I was sent just like him. And they're not going to be able to say how I was. They're going to have no idea. So yeah, Dad went to church, but I don't really know what he did. I don't know how he lived like Jesus did. I'm a little afraid of that. Even more so, if I can spread that out a little bit, today, everyone around you is hearing from the world on how to deal with what's going on. Whatever the news is saying is really important this week. Everyone is hearing from the world and all these experts that are getting paid to say what they're supposed to say. Here's the result of that. Mental issues are up. 19% of them are major. 1,000% increase in mental health emergency calls. 65% increase in online mental health counseling. That's the result of that. Where is the person talking about this? Where's the person talking to them about the gospel? Where's the person who's going to talk to them about Jesus, about the Holy Spirit? Who's the person that's going to help and stand in the gap and tell them about this? A guy standing up here for however long I've been up here, one time a week, is not enough. This is why we, all collectively, must leave this place today with the message of Jesus Christ and talk about it on Monday and on Tuesday, and on Wednesday, and on Thursday, and on Friday, and on Saturday. That's why after this, when you go to Porta Subs or wherever you go, that you're going to walk in there as a missionary sent by God, not just as a person ordering a sandwich, which sounds great right now. Generationally, there's many things that can separate us. Many things. But you know what unites us? One God. One faith. One baptism. That's what unites us. Verse 19, and then we'll finish. And for their sakes I sanctify themselves, that they themselves also may be sanctified in truth. What Jesus is saying is that I am consecrating myself. I am separating myself. I am living on purpose with my presence to do what God wants me to do. I am setting myself out to do that, and I will do nothing else. What is that? That is the words of a man who is living 100% for God. That is the words of a man who is not living 75% for God, 25% for him. That is a man who is all in. And who does he do it for? For himself? No. What does he say? For their sake I'm doing this. It's for their sake that I'm doing this. In other words, Jesus submits to the Father's will for his life. And guess what? If that's how he lived, then that's how we live. Someone once said that the Christian life is just Christ's life lived then in and through me today. And friends, if that is true, no, since that is true, then we need to live 100% consecrated for the mission of God. It doesn't matter if on Monday you're going to go work at a job site, at home, or unemployed, whatever that would. Don't see yourself as the world would see themselves. See yourself as a sent person who hears and obeys God in whatever place God has you in. Because if you do that, then you'll be living the life of a Christian. You'll be living the life just as Christ would be living today. And let me just tell you something. Over the next 10 years, your presence is needed more than you'll ever know. The next generation popping up, generation that's born after 2010, can you believe that? Generation Alpha, which is way better than millennial. I want Alpha. Generation Alpha. Man. They will be the most socially distant generation that has ever lived. And those are my kids. And friends, I'm asking you, don't let them live without hearing about Jesus. Make yourself available to be present in their life. Maybe it's 45 minutes on Sunday. Maybe it's volunteering at a VBS, going to school to help pack some bags for kids that are hungry. Whatever that looks like, guys, don't let them live without your presence in their life. Because what I'm afraid of is that the next time something like this happens, is it'll be a 3,000% increase in phone calls and a 100% increase in counselings. What I'm afraid of is that this generation, if they don't have the physical presence of Christians in their life, then they will just not hear about Jesus, because they're not going to Google how to become a Christian. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity to be able to just communicate your word today, God. I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would work in our hearts. That is, you would help us to really understand our role in this world. God, I feel like you make it so easy on us. You send us into the world to make disciples. It just sounds so easy, but it isn't. not for me. It's hard to just tell people about you. I don't know why. It's not always easy. It certainly doesn't seem convenient, God, but yet I know that there are people that need you. I know that there are people who need to hear the gospel. And so I want to pray for all of my friends here. First and foremost, God, I pray that you'd put somebody on their heart to share the gospel with. And that they would pursue that person with the same intensity that Jesus would pursue them. That they would be like Jesus and that they would be so willing to even just walk up right to them and say, follow me. God, I pray that you would give them that. I pray against the enemy, his works and effects. God, I pray that the enemy would not cause any division there, any doubt, guilt, shame, fear. God, I pray against all those things. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would just ignite your fruit in them. That they would have the joy and the peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and self-control that is needed to be able to share the gospel. God, I pray that you would pave the way and make these people obvious to them. I know, God, you changed my life. You know I didn't grow up with you. And if it wasn't for one man who was volunteering at a youth group, I don't know where I'd be today. Thank you for using him, God. Thank you for using somebody who wasn't educated in the Bible, just somebody who loved you and just wanted to serve. Thank you for allowing him to be able to change my story and hopefully the story of my children and my children's children. I pray for many opportunities here for everybody here, God, that they would have so many Jesus-empowered stories that dinner tables would be full of stories about people coming to you, even the ones we never thought would. I pray, God, as we sing this final song, that we can do so with hearts that are just so happy and thankful that we get to be sanctified by your truth, empowered by your Spirit, loved by you, God, in every way. God, for the forgiveness you give us and the grace and mercy that you show us, the blessings that you give us, Lord. We're so thankful for all those things. God, we need you. We need you so much. And so help us as we get to sing your praises. In Jesus' name, amen.
You're amazing, faithful, love's open door when I'm in.